So the first question is pretty simple. Shall Gavin Newsom be recalled, removed from the office of governor? And that's on the first page of the ballot, right underneath, like the instructions. Yeah, there's like the official ballot, and then right underneath that is the
pretty straightforward. Yes or no? Yeah. Right? That's your only two options.
And then the next page is candidates to succeed Gavin Newsom as governor if he is recalled. And there's 1, 2, 3 times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. It's like 46 candidates. And it's like pick one, vote for one out of 46.
You can only answer one question, or you can answer both, or you can skip both, of course. So I think we got to review that. You can vote no on the first one, and then also vote on the second question, just in case the yes vote wins. So you can do that. The governor wants you to vote no on the first one and skip the second one, even though I haven't been able to figure out exactly why that is, like something that is the strategic play for the governor's point of view. But so let's spend some time to talk about how the recall is structured this way, because theoretically, you can have 49.9% of voters voting no and wanting to keep Governor Newsom in office. But if the yes vote wins, whoever gets the most votes on the second question will become the governor. And given that there's 46 candidates, the person that gets the most votes on the second question can receive a very small amount of votes, as long as you just get the most. So this is something that people are looking at, and it's currently in a lawsuit right now, because you can have like a single digit percentage of voters determine who controls, you know, the sixth largest economy in the world, right? And this is, you know, considered undemocratic by a lot of people. And so this is currently in a federal court.
So it just got slapped down.
Oh, did it?
So yeah, I just read an article about it, and I was like, oh shit. Yeah.
So the courts, and this is how the law is written in California. So there's also efforts to obviously correct this. In California, you only need 12% of people who voted in the previous governor's election, I think, to put a recall question on the ballot. In other states, it's a much higher bar. You need on average, I think 25% to do a recall. So, you know, that's something that people are like, yeah, there shouldn't even be on a ballot, whatever.
Wait, sorry, what was the percent for California?
12%.
12%? Oh, okay. Yeah.
So it's it keeps the governor on his toes, I guess. This is not just him, any governor.
Yep.
Because it's relatively low bar. So that's one way that you could approach this as well. You know, there's going to be like 20 ways to approach the question. One way is like, you know, I don't agree with how this recall process was initiated and brought about. I think it's a lowball, cheap tactic, and therefore, you know, we shouldn't even be doing this, because, by the way, this is costing taxpayers, I think, up north of $250 million to have this election right now. And the actual governor election is in just 1 year. So some people obviously take issue with like the process, and this is one way you can vote. You just like, hey, I just don't agree with this process. I'm not gonna let whoever organized the recall do this. They should have just waited, or blah, blah, blah. So what are your thoughts on this?
I feel like that's why the governor and other Democrats are kind of like saying, you should just vote no and then not vote for a candidate. It's like sort of like to protest the entire process, I think, is maybe the justification for doing that. But I don't know. Maybe it's just that they want people to focus on finding the first question. Because I think I read an article a while ago that said that made the claim that maybe there's the potential for people to miss the first question on the ballot because it's so close to the introductory introductory sort of directions. There's like the directions right here, and then there's the question like right below it. So you think like maybe some people are looking at the directions and they're like, oh, this is just like the terms and conditions, I can just skip that. And then they go directly to the next question, which is like all the people to vote for, and then they miss the first question. That's what I heard was maybe one concern about how this ballot is laid out. But I don't personally feel like there's anything wrong with like voting for both questions. I don't think there's anything wrong with that, you know?
Yeah, I think it's just politics, as in like there's no real consequence. Well, there is actually a real consequence. I mean, from the governor's perspective, that he doesn't want you to vote on the second question, it seems like strategically that's not a good way to do it, because you should be planning for what if I actually lose the first question. We should try to get a Democrat, you know, maintain in the office from his point of view. So it seems like a mistake, in my opinion, to say just ignore the second question. They're putting all their eggs in the first question basket, put it that way. So, but I wonder what the stats are of people missing the first question. Like, can you imagine?
It's going to be so embarrassing. There's going to be some absurdly large percentage when it's all said and done.
Back to our education conversation. Like, yeah. Well, like we're fucked. Like if we can't figure out the critical reading of like, this is the first question.
It's right there. Yeah, I don't know, man. I feel like I don't agree with that strategy of only vote for one question to protest or for whatever reason, because don't tell me not to vote. I'm going to vote. That's not cool, bro. Don't tell me what to not do. Plus, it's like that's part of why that lawsuit got thrown out. The lawsuit that you were talking about, I read an article. It talked about like the argument that they were making is that it violated the 14th Amendment. It violated one person, one vote, because it made the claim that like people who vote no on the first question, they're second, then they're not allowed to vote on the second question because it's like they already voted no. But that's not actually how it works, because both questions are tallied up separately. They're kind of mutually exclusive questions. So the judge was like, yeah, this is not on legally sound ground. So yeah, just, you know, vote for both ones. It's fine. Yeah.
Let's go around the room and like get people's opinions on whether. Oh,
before we do that, can I ask a question to sort of clarify? Like, I'm trying to understand sort of why this even came about, right? So like, first of all, how many signatures did they need for this recall to even come in place? And then second question is sort of, what is the premise and why people want to recall them again?
We'll go into like all the reasons, but just the background. Let's see. So there has been 6 attempts to recall Governor Newsom since he came in office. And one of the main reasons that this one was successful was because of actually the deadline for collecting signatures. So when you start the process, you have a certain amount of time to collect signatures. And this specific one was successful because a judge extended the deadline, because the organizers said, you know, COVID affected our, you know, how much signatures we can get. Some people have issues with that, but I don't have issues with that, because it makes sense. So let's see if I wrote down why exactly how many percent of, but I'd have to Google it again, because I don't have it like on hand.
It's like you said, 12%, right? Of the total number of people who voted in the last election. You take 12% of that total number, that's the number of signatures they need, right?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So they got 1.5 million. That was 12.5%. So they got that. because they were able to convince enough people that, you know, the governor, this should be on the ballot. And this was mostly because of COVID stuff. So there's a good amount of reasons. I'll read them. I'll read most of the major ones just so we expect what to discuss this morning, and then we'll go through each of them one by one. And like, if any of these are, you know, strong enough reasons for anyone to recall the governor. So a lot of it is COVID stuff. So during COVID, there was, he had the one episode where he went to the French Laundry, you know, while the guidance was everybody stay home, don't meet with people that's more than like three families or whatever. But he appeared to have broken that guidance. So that made a lot of people angry. Next is the school closures. Some people are unhappy with how the state issued their guidelines or whatever, and made schools or didn't open schools soon enough, or didn't have the best policies for how to educate students during the pandemic. And there's the tier system where, remember, we were like tier orange, purple, or red or whatever, and that caused businesses to close down once you were in a certain tier. And then, you know, if you go to this tier, to the other tier, you can open, but then if it gets worse, you have to close again. So that was a real headache for business owners, and they really didn't like that. Then there's the some more of his COVID policies. He is giving $5.2 billion in back rent and rent relief. So this is pretty unprecedented, just putting a lot of money out the door so people can pay their rents. And people view this as unfair, because what if you sacrificed a lot for your family just to pay rents, whereas you could have just not paid rent, not get evicted, and then just get this free money from the government. So some people think that's unfair or irresponsible. So there's that. There are some rebates due to the budget surplus. California had a like huge surplus this past year, and then they gave its own COVID checks. I think it was like $600 recently. Okay, so that's a lot of the COVID stuff. Next is EDD fraud. You know, the Department of people that give out the unemployment checks, they had to give a lot of money out recently, and they gave $11 billion in fraudulent claims that has already been identified, and $19 billion in suspicious claims. This is out of a total so far of about $265 billion. So, you know, people think this is obviously unfair. We're giving money to people who don't deserve it. And then once this blew up, the department had to kind of put down the clamps on the process. And so this caused a lot of people who did need the money to have to wait longer. Calls, you know, like very low percentage of calls to the agency were being answered. So basically it was a, you know, very difficult time for people, blah, blah, blah. So this mismanagement is also saying, hey, that, you know, this is the governor's fault. He didn't fix it. And so this is another reason we should recall the governor. Let's see. Yeah. And then there's like, you can talk about the wildfires, homelessness, you know, crime. These are kind of constant things to discuss. And just saying that Governor Newsom didn't do anything about it. So I would say those are the main reasons for this recall that pushed a lot of people to sign the thing.
And he's also a communist.
And he's a communist. That's so we're gonna kind of go into those probably one by one, whatever is more popular, and whatever pushes your buttons, so to speak. But there is, you know, he's a Democratic governor in a very strong Democratic state. So that if you voted for him or if you lean left, you know, there's has to be a really good reason that would push you to recall the governor, of course. But we'll try to explore these things. And of course, he's not perfect. So, and it's not like just because he's a Democrat, we have to support him 100%, right? So let's get into this conversation. So the first thing that we talked about was the process of the recall. Let's go around the room and see what people think about it. If you think that, so what do we say, the process, what are the flaws, and like, is that reason enough for you to just say, you know what, this is a waste of money, like, you know, why are Republicans doing this, blah blah blah, it's an easy choice, I'm done, I already filled out my ballot, whatever. Thoughts?
I'm personally curious what all of you think about this 12% threshold. Personally, I think that percentage is pretty low to have to do that, considering how much money is needed for a recall to happen. It doesn't proportionally speaking, I don't think it makes sense. I think the percentage should be a little bit closer to like 20 to 25%. That's just my personal opinion, just from hearing how much money it costs.
Yeah, I'm going to have to agree with that. It's like a pretty low threshold. I think the last time this recall happened, it was like the guy, Gray Davis, was recalled. And there wasn't any real major scandal that happened under his watch. It was just like, there were a lot of rolling brownouts. Yeah, I know. Another thing is that Gray Davis also was kind of boring as a human being, I guess. That was part of it. Because the person running against him was Arnold Schwarzenegger. What, you gonna vote against the Terminator? Come on. So I think, the threshold is too low. So if there's a lot of hype surrounding one candidate, or if there's just one little thing, it's like, yeah, get him out of office. Meanwhile, it's like, you know, it's very hard to remove the president. It's very hard to remove everybody else. So I don't know. It's weird. Well, and we're like, go ahead.
Yeah, because I thought it's because California has so much people. So if you raise it to 12%, then 20% or 25%, then instead of like a million, you need like 3 million people to like do it. But I don't know.
Of the voters, though, right? It's not 12% of California, but 12% of the voters.
Oh yeah. If it was all of California, 12% seems okay with me, but because it's of the voters, I think it should be a little bit more.
Oh, right. Sorry.
Yeah, and it could be that like a lot of the people who signed on to this recall didn't necessarily vote in the last election. It's just the number needs to be the same.
Oh, but, all right.
Yeah. But I agree with Jackie's point though. Obviously, like theoretically, the scale of it should be the same. Like, you know, 12% of like Wisconsin voters versus 12% of California voters, it shouldn't theoretically make a difference. But on the ground, like to get double the amount of people, which would be, like Jackie said, 3 million voters, that's it's significant enough that I do hesitate to put that in, because it would make it almost impossible. And it is fair that, you know, there is election every 4 years, but I think there are reasons to have a recall process. And I don't know, like I right now actually I don't mind too much that it's 12.5%. It seemed to be right at the threshold of like you would achieve that if there's big reasons to recall the governor. Because like, for example, there's been 6 attempts to recall this governor, and it didn't reach that threshold. It only reached the threshold because of, you know, these are, you know, extraordinary times, and because they had an extra month, I think month and a half to get signatures. So it does kind of seem to be at this cool, like a good threshold. And I would definitely be singing a different tune if, Governor Newsom is actually recalled. I'd be like, oh no, we got to change the process. So, you know, is that hypocritical? Well, I'm a results oriented, put it that way. But I like the idea of like keeping our leaders nervous and like, you know what I mean? It doesn't seem like it's
on their toes.
Yeah, it's not like abuse, because it's not like we actually have this question like super easy every year, just because the other party doesn't like the governor. This was kind of extraordinary times. So, does anyone have any other thoughts on this, on the process itself, like the recall process?
Shouldn't it, like, be, I agree with you that shouldn't it be better if after we said yes or no on recall, and then we have another form after, like, a month, they send us another form of, like, if he's getting recalled, so now choose your, like, candidate.
Are you concerned that people are confused on this, on the form as it is right now?
Yeah, I think, because right now, like, they're just gonna, people who don't follow it, they're just gonna think, oh, Gavin Newsom's already recalled, let me choose my candidates.
Yeah, that's true. There might be some people who aren't aware of what's going on exactly, and then this might be a little confusing.
Oh, I was just gonna say, does anyone know why? Because I'm so maybe that might be a San Francisco thing, but I know that when the mayor race a few years ago was based on ranked choice. And I'm really curious why the state doesn't choose to like vote for candidates via ranked choice as well.
Ranked choice is complicated.
It is complicated. Yeah.
It is.
They just implemented the system in the New York mayoral election that just happened this year. Yeah. That was the first implementation of ranked choice in that entire state. And it was like kind of a clusterfuck. Like it was really hard for them to figure out how to count those ballots properly. There's a lot of like blah, 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 blah. So it's like in San Francisco, we've gotten used to it, but it takes time for both voters to know how to do that system and for the vote counters to like count it properly and like not screw it up in any way so that everybody can agree that, yes, this was executed properly. But I agree. I think we should have a ranked voting system. I think it'd be great because then you would be able to vote for more people. You'd be able to vote your conscience a little more, but it's more complicated.
Yeah, I wonder, fuck, what was I gonna say? So there's two issues here, right? Is it hard for the administrators to administrate the election, or is it hard for the voters to follow directions? Because ranked choice is pretty straightforward for voters, right? Choose your top three, I think.
Yeah, yeah, if anything, it'd be sort of like, the logistical side, like how do you sort of define who wins and how do you count all the votes and whatnot?
Well, those questions are solved, as in ranked choice is a superior system than what we just did or what we're doing right now. It's just there's also an in-between problem, which is how do voters understand how the votes are counted? Because even as you've seen in the presidential election, right, where even Trump's lawyers said they were contesting the results of the election, right? And even Trump's lawyers were like, well, reasonable people knew that the election was over and Trump lost. But the people who just didn't want to believe how votes were counted in America just decided like, no, I'm pretty sure something went wrong and we have to go do a protest because it's not adding up. I mean, so this is the problem when you have a even more complicated system. You risk the public, even if the instructions to vote are simple, they're like, well, why is this so complicated? I don't think they're counting correctly. And then, so the problem is the public, you can't trust them to read how the votes are counted and why it's 100% up to speed or whatever. This is kind of a tangent.
You're saying that a ranked choice voting system would like open up the system itself to more attack from people who want to discredit the results if it goes the way. Yeah.
Well, I feel like smart people that know how it works.
Yeah, they're just going to argue that this is too complicated.
Exactly.
But I feel like they're already making that argument anyway.
This is true.
Right. But they're already being like, oh, the election was stolen. So I see that point. However, it's like if they got their way, they would not want to live in a democracy. They would just want their chosen rulers to rule over everything, right? And like that's the argument they're making essentially, which is like this system is fundamentally corrupt. Let's get rid of it. So making it more complicated, like they're already lost at this, or not lost, but like I don't think we're going to get them on board no matter what. So we might as well try something that's like more more democratic and better for us. And specifically with the state of California, I feel like there's enough of a desire for it. It's just, I don't know. It just hasn't happened yet. The state of Maine has ranked choice voting, I believe. Yeah, I think over the next couple decades, and it does take decades, you'll start to see more and more ranked choice voting, I think, at a statewide level. It just hasn't happened yet.
Maybe we need to teach this in our high school or something.
Man, you gotta let people know.
What's the voting then?
Ranked choice actually involves some math, like a lot of math.
That's true.
Yeah, you should teach it in school as like a little exercise, because it's like the way that it's practiced is that the candidate who wins has to get 51% of the vote, 51% of the total vote. So there's a process where it's like the lowest ranked candidate who has the least amount of votes, their votes get redistributed to everybody else over and over until somebody is found to be super cool.
Mm. But to answer the other half of Jackie's question, it's cost too. So if you want two ballots sent out, that will almost double the cost. So it's like, which you can argue is worth it for sure. But the powers that be were like, that's expensive, because there's a lot of overtime in the Department of Elections across the state every time there's an election. So she gets expensive.
I personally kind of wish that the both questions were just combined into one question, right?
Oh, that
where
makes
it's
sense.
Like, yeah, vote for your preferred candidate, and Newsom's one of the candidates. And then it would be that would put to rest the questions of like, wait, but 5 million people voted yes, but the candidate who won only got 1 million, you know? So if it's more of a head-to-head thing, I feel like that would be more upfront, personally.
Let's keep moving to the other things, just because our clock is running. So the main questions that people are angry about are the COVID responses. We can start with the first one, which is the French Laundry episode. This caused a lot of people to sign the recall petition thing. So, let's hear some thoughts around the room. Or is there any background?
My was fucking pissed. He's a Republican. Hey. He was like, "What the fuck is this shit?" And he was just like all trash talking Gavin Newsom and how like rules for the fee and not for me kind of thing.
Wait, what?
It's like the rules is for you, but it doesn't work for me. Yeah, rules for the fee, but not for me.
Not for me.
Yeah, fee,
So interesting.
My like was really pissed. I'm pretty sure he signed the petition too. I think he did sign the petition. He was telling me to sign it. He was like, go online and sign this. And I'm like, no.
I thought it was really embarrassing, that whole episode.
Oh, yeah.
It was just embarrassing.
Just dumb. He took precautions. Like, everyone needs to get tested 2 days before you have dinner with the governor.
Wait, Carmen, you're on mute.
Ah,
I think your voice is getting picked up by Stevens.
Yeah, let's try it. We're just going to share this mic. Hang on. Test. Carmen, can you say something?
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you through Stevens' mic.
You just sit over here if you want. Carmen was asking, do you think the governor and everyone that was at that party, do you think they did like a test yourself before you come eat dinner with us?
Oh, I don't know. Did
probably
they?
Not, I think.
Honestly. Probably not. I don't think
he does
so.
That, right?
But like, it's just, it looks really bad. It makes you look like such an out of touch piece of crap. The French Laundry in particular. Like, if he was eating at like, I don't know, Mel's Drive-In or at In-N-Out. But the French Laundry, that's like well known as like one of the cream of the crop of the cream, the crop cream. So delicious.
It's even crazy. I think the mayor was also had the exact same episode at French Laundry.
If you guys really?
Mayor she
was
there? Reed.
Was it
not
a separate
at the same
event?
Party. Separate party.
Oh, that sounds familiar.
Yeah, that was
but it didn't really blow up in her face necessarily. I don't quite remember that.
So I mean, so you guys think this is like, I mean, obviously it's bad, but is it like, does it say something about their ability to lead or something? Like, is it in doubt now that they broke this rule?
I don't think so. I mean, it definitely does just looks so bad and like gives them an excuse for an attack. And you kind of left yourself open like this. So, you know.
I didn't see his reaction. How did he react when the public found out and that when there was public outcry? Well, how did he react? I don't know.
I think it was something like, I'm paraphrasing from my that like he's trying to cover himself, saying that it was for like the job for California to talk about like the future or California or something like that, and like some bullshit excuse.
Yeah, all right. I think he apologized, but everyone knows he fucked up, so to speak. Obviously, a PR disaster.
I don't think I expect my governor to like hold himself and isolate himself like a year into COVID, just because as a human being, you need to have social interaction in order to be like healthy and stuff. But I think he should have, you know, if he goes out, then he should make it clear that everyone should too, but you need to take the right proper safety precautions.
Right, but he hid it from us, though. That was the problem.
Yeah, and actually, at that point in time, I thought you weren't even supposed to go out because there's like more than two or three households. Like you weren't even supposed to do that at all, and he did it.
And not indoor dining, and it was an indoor dining event, and it wasn't even like Newsom's birthday. It was a birthday for some lobbyist, which like looks really bad. Like special interests are getting in on the ground floor. So I don't know what it necessarily says about his competence. Or judgment. I guess it calls this judgment into question, but I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I also found myself kind of making excuses for him.
Yeah, me too.
Because I don't think anybody here was perfect during COVID. I wasn't. I mean, you know, a lot of people weren't. But I think if you compare this actions to his like macro policy, like, you know, what policy he set for the state, I think he generally made the right decisions for being aggressive on COVID. So if you compare his individual actions and his, you know, little mistakes versus the policies he set for the whole state, you know, what do you weigh more heavily? I think the aggressive COVID policies save more lives versus he made this mistake, which makes him look bad. And this also interesting to note is that, you know, on the if you lean to the right, if you're a Republican and you obviously disagree with the Democratic Party's policies or whatever, you generally value like individual rules more, and you value like, you know, character or virtue more. I know this means anything, like especially with like Trump in office, but generally speaking, if you're raised on the right, you're like, oh, this guy is morally unsound, and therefore that's higher reason for me to dislike him. So that's kind of like generally how that explains why I think people on the right are so outraged about it more than people on the left. Any other thoughts on this specific episode?
No.
Okay, let's talk about the school closures. I don't know, maybe Bowden can shed more light on it. Was there anything specific from the state that affected how school districts were run, like any rules or guidance that you can shed light on?
Well, the issue is, like, even if I didn't look into it much in terms of the state because I was mainly focused on San Francisco so much, but and because of that, San Francisco never like opened during the pandemic until like this school year. So like, and a lot of it is because of the teacher union in San Francisco. So it's like, I don't really have much input in terms of the state.
Okay. Yeah, definitely. I think as San Francisco like made the choice, like, hey, we don't really have a plan. We're not coming back for a while. Yeah.
Right. At least at the high school level, I know that they definitely opened up at the elementary school level in April. But yeah.
I don't have any details. I saw, I think there was an article that he kind of, in response to this recall effort, the governor started to like tweak some guidance, and there's a paywall, so fuck it. well, the one thing, for example, I mean, he's mandating vaccines for all teachers and staff in the state. So if you disagree with that, that's a reason that you would, you know, vote for the recall of Governor Newsom. If anyone wants to speak to that. So that's one of his policies regarding school stuff. Or you just think that he should have done more to reopen schools because schools are closed and parents are pissed.
Yeah, I think my answer was a little bit miffed. Maybe not pissed off. I'm not sure what his political leanings are necessarily, but like, I got the impression that during lockdown, he was really getting frazzled by the fact that like, he had to juggle working for the and his kids were out of class and everything. And it's just like, it's a lot, especially when you have younger kids who are like really, they need more attention. They need more engagement. And usually they're getting that at like elementary school, but like, so I think it took a huge toll on a lot of parents, and like none of us have kids, so it's like it's less of an issue for us. But
and you're maybe some, in the office, right?
He was like half and half, and then there was also a time where it was like everybody was doing 1 week on and 1 week off, except for me because I'm part time anyway. So it's like I'm already 1 week off, 1 week on. But I think I had another coworker who has kids, and she was also maybe a little frazzled, but yeah, my definitely, he looked tired. So
I guess I'm going to push back a little bit, because in a lot of ways, and like have like doing more guidelines to get schools reopened is kind of a balancing act with the union as well.
Yeah.
Cause like, as much as, even if Gavin Newsom says like, oh, we have to reopen these schools, the union sort of has to have agreements with like the state of California to say, okay, how are we going to get this to happen? So I wouldn't put the blame completely on him, because again, there needs to be like an agreement between the union and the state of California to make that happen.
Right. Not only that, but aren't like school districts, like they're very diverse. Like every school district has their own thing, and it's very,
they're pretty autonomous, right?
They're autonomous.
They're different by whatever county you live in.
So. Yeah, exactly. So it's very, very, there's very diversity of
right. And experiences. So that's what I'm trying to get at, right? Because not only is he, not only is he trying to balance the union, but he's trying to balance it with the union from every county of California.
Right.
So it can get complicated very fast.
Yeah. I'd say if every public school was run under the same California-wide state system, then he would be more directly responsible for whatever, you know, goes wrong or whatever goes right. But I feel like he's less responsible if there's like isolated incidents in different counties, because it's like they're so autonomous and the balancing act and everything. So I don't know.
Yeah, I would push back and say, you know, we pay him for his executive leadership. So while there are all these, you know, things flying around, things he has to balance, but like 50 things at once, obviously. That's why we pay him so much, and that's why it's a big job. So that's kind of why obviously parents are pissed, because like, who do we blame, right? You got to blame the boss, the leader. So like, it's your job to go figure it out and make it happen for us. So I'm curious, Bowden, what was your position on the during the whole, you know, I know the teachers were definitely didn't want to come in. Were you on that side where like, hey, I don't want to go in, or would you be like, hey, I want to serve my
students? I wanted to go in. And when they said they were going to try to reopen schools in April, I was hoping that they were going to reopen it for high schools. I wanted to go in as soon as possible. Cause again, I could sort of, not only just for myself, but I could sense that the kids just lacked that social interaction and learning wasn't as, the quality of learning wasn't quite there as well. I guess as part of it is quality of teaching wasn't quite there because of online learning. But yeah, I'm on the boat of trying to reopen as early as possible, but I understand that I don't like my opinion does not represent majority of the union. So yeah.
Hey, yeah, my boss was pissed because like there were a bunch of like I think he said it was a CDC like investigation kind of thing of like how kids won't really get COVID. His kids are like 10 or something, and like the amount of like kids getting COVID at that age was like zero or something, and that like he was pissed at like, oh, why don't they open the school? At least that's what I got from him. I'm paraphrasing, so because I wasn't really listening to him because most of the time I'm sleepy.
Your sounds really angry. But I do agree with him on this issue. I feel like at least San Francisco Unified School District was not necessarily meeting the new information that was coming out about how it was transmitted within schools. And I felt like we just should have prioritized vaccinating teachers and then gotten them back into the classroom like ASAP. But I don't know. I don't have a kid. I don't have any skin in the game. So it's like, I can't really say. You know?
The world burns because of people like you, Will.
Oh,
what do you mean?
Because you don't have skin in the game.
Martin Luther King.
But you don't care.
I mean, it is what it is. Some people just want to watch. I just want to. There was no fire yesterday at the bonfire. The world had burned. I would have been much happier.
I kind of agree with what Will said when he said people don't, or our government didn't react upon the new information, because kind of going on a tangent, I like going to the SF Public Library by Irving, the Sunset one, and they were closed for a year and a half. Huh. And I was like, that's like, I just feel like they just took advantage of this time to just close the building so they don't have to go into work. Cause I'm like, come on, like you could have at least done the to-go thing that the main library does where you just order books and you pick it up. They didn't even do that. And I was like, I don't know about you, but what do I pay my taxpayer monies for? Like, you can't even do something like that for me in times of COVID.
It goes to my salary. It goes to my salary, okay?
My salary too.
Excluding that.
Your pension, man.
Yeah, pays for that pension. I agree. I
feel like generous pension.
I think overall, for the most part, I think it's good that the city and county of San Francisco was more skittish and more hesitant to reopen things in general, but on specific things. But then when you get to the specific things of how it affected me, it's like, they should have made that one exception. However, it's like, but then you sacrifice the really good safeguarding. So it's like,
right.
I agree, but I also disagree. You know what I mean? And I feel that feeling where it's like, oh, I wish they had made an exception for the one part of the government that I really like.
Be but it we have schooling leadership or positions in all like government departments. So I feel like at that level, like they should be able to say, okay, like we can do this in a safe manner.
Yeah, I guess there wasn't any. Yeah, they should have put more effort into it. I agree.
Like it just kind of seemed like, oh, we'll just shut down everything.
Yeah. So, okay. Yeah, if we have time, we'll go into specific like city stuff, because there's also, you know, on the board, there's a school board recall effort, and there's also the district attorney effort. So if we have time, we'll go into more specific San Francisco races. But going back, welcome, Anna. We're going over the main reasons that people are voting, that this is on the ballot and that we're voting for. So next, we just went over schools. People are angry about school closings and stuff. But next, we're going to go businesses. Let's talk about the tier system. So that was implemented, of course, by the state. And everyone remembers the red tier, orange tier, purple tier. And so, people's thoughts, right? Because mainly business owners didn't enjoy this system because it caused their stores to close. And the guidelines were, you know, based on the statistics, you know, the rate of positivity rate and something else. You could have been in one tier one week and another tier the next week. And so mainly the complaint is from business owners, but what are your guys' thoughts on the system that the state implemented?
I thought it was fine. I mean, like, no skin in the game, so, like, I didn't care.
And you just want to watch the world burn, Jackie. Oh, my God.
But unlike school, like, business is, like, high traffic area with, like, high contagious area. So, like, you know, it makes sense that, like, it's so, you know, like, messy. But, yeah, a lot of business definitely, like, took a hit. Like, one of my favorite, like, place to go for, like, brunch, I forgot, it's Millbury Pancake House. They got closed down. And then Cliff House got closed down, the one by Ocean Beach. Got closed down forever.
Cliff what?
Cliff House.
Oh, the Cliff House, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It got closed down forever. So, you know, I get why they're pissed, too.
But you know, Millbury Pancake House is out of business?
That's what I heard, yeah.
Hopefully they're back. Because I pass by them on my commute, like, every day. Yeah. And I thought I saw, like, a line of cars at one point where they were doing takeout service. Oh, I got to look into that. I don't know if they're out of business or not. Yeah. You could, yeah. That sucks, though. That place is kind of an institution. Is that going to affect your vote? I don't know. Now I'm leaning yes. Pancakes got to me, man. Oof.
But, yeah, so not just the, you know, not just how it affected, you know, yourself, but, yeah, let's try to take a little more objective view on whether you think this policy was good or not. Because obviously the service sector was demolished, right? People lost their jobs for a long time. Let's try to empathize with the argument that this was a bad system. What were they saying? Like, I think the proponents are saying that maybe the county should have handled it, right? Like, had their own guidelines instead of the state mandating closures.
But isn't that already true? Because didn't San Francisco sort of enact something on their own that was before what the state did?
I think it was before, but once the state came out with this, everyone had to follow it.
Oh, I see.
I think everyone did.
Well, I guess I need a better frame of reference because, like, I don't know any other system other than California system. And I'm really curious, like, for example, I know New York had a huge outbreak in the very beginning, but it clearly died down. And so I'm curious, like, what system did they come up with that helped with that? Does that sort of make sense? Like, I don't have anything to compare it to, so I can't really say, like, is it that much worse or better than, you know? So.
Yeah, I can't speak to the specifics, but for sure, certain states had very lax guidelines in comparison. I'll look up for you right now what the general comparison is between just different states.
And then while you look at it, I'm just going to say, like, if you ask me, I preferably like stricter guidelines. And I think his were strict, but in a sense, but it always, like, it changed constantly because of where you live, or depending on where you live, it could change constantly. But I preferably would choose to have stricter guidelines because I think in the end it would have saved more lives.
I agree. I think strict guidelines were good. My only complaint theoretically is just the rate at which it changed. And I think that's most people's complaint in the state. It's like, I think most people in the state would and still agree with a stricter COVID approach, just not necessarily like, oh, the guidelines are changing every couple of weeks. But on the other hand, it's like, the more we learn about the disease, you want your guidelines to reflect the latest information about the disease, right? So I don't know. It's like, it's hard to say.
But what about the people who live in, like, rural areas? I think for a city, because it's so dense, I would say stricter rules. But for rural areas, I would probably, it depends, I guess.
Yeah, that was the main argument for having counties manage it more. So theoretically, the state's strategy was that it was, you know, data-based. So that would capture, if you had a more rural county, your cases per 1,000 people or per 10,000 people, would already be lower because you have lower transmission rates. So theoretically, it already covers more rural areas. The difficulty is when you have a county that has, you know, one big urban area and then a bunch of other rural places, that your urban areas will obviously drive your case rates up, and then that will cause the rural places to also be shut down in a lot with the rest of the county. So that is one, you know, that's one very, that's a very good point against that type of policy. You guys see this, just quick Google the COVID data. This is per 1 million, so it accounts for population differences. If we find California, so this is rated from top to bottom. So, and you can kind of get a flavor of the type of policy. So, like, you know, for sure, Tennessee, Mississippi, Louisiana, they're very strong Republican states. So I'm gonna guess that their policy wasn't as strict as California. And so they're up here up top. And in fact, I think Rhode Island is probably maybe the only more independent leaning states out of all of these top 10 or so. So we'll look at California, and we are, you know, over here, I think like in the middle, no, near the bottom. So, and there are other graphs that show general, like, you know, what party the counties lean toward and the case rates. And of course, fact check me on this, but so there definitely seems to be a correlation between stricter, stronger on COVID policies versus more lax on COVID policies. So does that answer your question, Bowden, on like other ways that people could have did their COVID response by state level?
Sort of. I was just curious if there's a system that they implemented that's different from the tier system that we have in California. That's all. But I mean, I know that takes a lot of research to look into, but I was just curious if anyone knew, just so that I can sort of get an idea.
Right. I would be curious to know, like, Maine's policy, state policy regarding COVID versus California, just because Maine's all the way on the bottom.
Yeah, but and again, I get that it's a little harder to figure that out, but yeah, it is what it is.
I would just contrast the, you know, super liberal California one with the super conservative state like Mississippi, where actually I'd have to check it, but I would say that they literally didn't have a policy. So that's like the clearest contrast to California even trying a policy. Some states just didn't have any policy. And that's literally what some people are campaigning on. Like, this is my plan as a leader. We're not gonna do anything. We're just gonna let us figure it out. You know, if you own your own restaurant and you want to have these rules, go ahead, blah, 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 blah. So.
But your question, your initial question was the purple tier system good enough for California?
Mm-hmm.
And then Bowden's question was, I don't know, because I'd have to look at how other states who are doing really well in terms of keeping the numbers down.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. We'll have to look into that, because I was just comparing, like, you know, strictness of policy, but there's also,
right.
Yeah, I wonder if they also did things differently.
And then also for the businesses that were affected, didn't the state actually provide like funds for those businesses too? I mean, granted, I don't think they gave them enough to stay afloat, to be honest with you, but weren't they given some funds though during the pandemic?
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Okay. They were, you can look up, there's a website that the federal government set up, because the money came from the federal government. And
I see.
You can look up literally any business to see how much they were given. And a very significant amount of these payments, whatever, they were forgiven. Like, there were loans, but most of them were forgiven. So it was free money. And they were very, very varying, like, rules, as in, you know, some, like, you know, there was a controversy, I think, like, Wendy's or some shit, like, a huge corporate company got, like, billions in the loan, right? But obviously, it wasn't supposed to be for these big companies. So it's very inconsistent. But Yeah, so there are definitely small businesses that fell through the crack and had to close down. So, but then I guess with any, without any detailed statistics or whatever, it's hard to say exactly if the, you know, the program was bad.
Yeah, I guess I asked that question as kind of like pushback against that argument, because it's like, yes, it affected a lot of businesses because they need to close down. But and because the policy was constantly changing, but they also got support. So it just sounds like, yeah, they're just being upset about the change that's constantly happening and just not being, and obviously the business getting affected by it. So
yeah. In your mind, does the point that a lot of businesses were affected, do you think that the fact that the federal government gave a lot of money out to the business owners, does that negate it? Like, is that like a, is it a moot point, the fact that businesses were frustrated, in your mind?
Yeah, to some extent.
For sure.
My friend owns like a pho place that basically does like lunch only for like the corporate buildings around downtown.
Mm-hmm.
And like he said he was basically like, or his family was basically like freaking broke, and he wasn't sure how to, like, even with the federal like funding and whatnot.
Do you know if he applied and got any
assistance? He only mentioned like, yeah, he got money from like government to help stay afloat, but they were barely holding on, and they had to fire like two other staff members. So right now it's just his mom, his dad, and him and his aunt that's working, compared to back then when it was like open 100%, it was like 8 people that was working. Now it's just like them 4. Yeah. And that's like a 4 everything now.
Are they not gonna bounce back, you think, or what?
They said they're gonna keep doing takeouts only, no more dine-in, because operation calls and like, you know, it is a lot less like stressful dealing with the dine-in people and the policy up for it.
Mm.
And I also know that like all these like outdoor dining areas are paid by the government to like construct. You know, you guys have been seeing like restaurants building like these patio area.
Yeah, those parklets.
Yeah,
yeah, they're basically like built with the money funding by the government. That's all I know. Yeah.
Yeah, well, probably not all of them. I know there are funds that you can apply for to build it, and you have to have a permit, of course, but I don't think all of them are fully funded by government money. So businesses are taking a hit on those too.
But I don't even know if it's taking a hit anymore, because they're using it to like profit from it, right? Like at some point they will profit from it. It just depends on timing, right? So I don't even know if you can consider that, or I guess you can call it taking a hit, but in the long run, because even San Francisco has now said they're going to stay permanently, right?
Yeah.
At some point they will make profit from it.
I think it was a serendipitous investment opportunity. You know, it was like prior to COVID, investing in a parklet was like a pretty rare occurrence, and it wasn't like a pretty common thing where you could expand the square footage of your restaurant is essentially expanded or nearly doubled for some businesses, you know, so then they can get that many more people and seat them.
Right.
Yeah. Now it's an option that's like pretty common. So it's almost a good thing. Well, I don't know about that, but the fact that these parklets are going to be permanent, I think, is a good thing. If the city, and they were well within their rights to be like, yeah, you got to get rid of these parklets. If the city had gone in that direction, it would have been a really bad investment. But I think it aligns with the city's more broad goals of trying to reduce car usage within the city limits in general, I think. Right? That, and the slow streets things,
yeah, absolutely,
also aligns with that general trend. And, you know, making parts of Market Street inaccessible to most cars. So I think the city is moving in that direction. Parklets only help push us in that direction.
Other thoughts on the business and the tier system point?
I thought it was good overall.
Yeah.
And what else were we supposed to do? Nothing? I think it was good that something was done. Yeah. And
that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know it like at least made sense, right? It's like based on your case rate.
Exactly. So.
Okay, in the interest of time, let's move on. What we got? This is a good question. This is the Governor Newsom, because of the budget surplus, he said, I'm going to give a lot of people like money back, basically. And specifically, this one is in back rents. So this is a very, you know, very controversial question, because it really tests your, you know, your notion of fairness. So basically, if you didn't pay rent for like, you know, the last year, whether you couldn't afford it or you're just a bad tenant or whatever, you weren't going to get evicted. And then the governor announced that we're going to pay all of it, right? If you apply for it, and maybe if your landlord applies for it, we're going to pay all of it. So maybe you owe, you know, because rent's expensive, maybe you're like $25,000. The state's going to not give that to you, maybe, but eventually you give it to your landlord. So this is very controversial. So let's hear some opinions on it, because some people, like I said, who sacrifice a lot to pay the rent and, you know, ate like ramen noodles once a day to pay the rent, they're screwed right now. They're not going to get, there are stipulations that they can actually apply for some money from this program if they sacrifice a lot. But generally speaking, you can expect that if you sacrifice to pay your rent, you're not getting the full rent amount as a shitbag would get. So thoughts on this controversial policy?
Yes, my was pissed about that too.
Yeah, I was pissed too when I heard about it, just because I'm empathizing with people who maybe sacrifice, right, to pay the expensive rent.
That's basically like his idea too, like, or his how he sees it too. Like, he was like working so hard, and he was like, there were talks of like us, like me, like, and my coworker not going in and like basically not working during COVID, but he really pushed us to like actually like, oh, we still need Jackie and we still need to like work and keep this place running. And then now the government is saying, oh yeah, we'll pay for rent. So it's like, it makes him feel like less, like the things that he did was like less, you know what I mean?
It's like, really interesting that y'all bring this up though, because the way that I interpreted this was more about supporting the people that are doing literally everything that y'all are mentioning, literally like eating like cup noodles because they can't afford to eat meals, but also doing all that and not still being able to afford rent.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm like trying to empathize with that as well. So, but it's interesting that you like bring it up in that way, because obviously that did happen. There are people that had to like pinch pennies in order to be able to pay rent and then not be able to get that money back after paying the rent. So it's really interesting to hear your perspectives on this.
Yeah, I think the seems like the difference, the key thing that would be nice to know, of course, is what portion of the population are in the, you know, shitbag right. category versus the, you know, actually good people trying to make ends meet.
Right.
That's actually very very interesting point to keep in the back of our minds, because if you were against the governor and if you thought that, you know, these are just supporting welfare queens or whatever, you're imagining that this population is much bigger than perhaps it actually is.
Yeah.
So I mean, when it comes to this question, you know, how do you approach it, right? Because I was sure, like for me, I was struggling with this question too, because, and you'll notice this is almost the same question as forgiving university debt, for example. Right, where people have sacrificed to pay their loans and then suddenly the government's talking about forgiving it, right? So just keep in mind these similar thoughts. For me, you know, I ended up being okay with this policy because the argument that it encourages bad behavior it's only true if you expect the government to do this consistently and in the future, which no one could have foreseen that the government would do this. And no one can foresee that it'll be done in the future. So if you're going to be not paying rent as we go hopefully into back to normal, and you're just saying, no, I'm pretty sure the government is going to bail me out, right? Obviously, you don't know that, and it's probably not going to happen, and you're probably going to get evicted, and you're going to have an eviction on your record, and that makes it extremely hard to rent anywhere else in the state. So that argument where it encourages bad behavior, that is like, that's been resolved to me. So ultimately, I think this is a good policy because, I don't know, it makes things, it balances the books and the accounts. And we had extra money, so it's like, I guess there were, you know, it was obviously a question of what you're going to do with the extra money, and he decided to make things right due to the pandemic. So, other thoughts?
I concur.
Yeah, I don't know about, like, if people who actually lost their homes. I mean, you'd have to be, like, really kind of innocent and naive when you were like back, you owed rent money and you weren't getting evicted and you didn't have anywhere to go to actually leave where you were. I feel sorry for, I'm sure there's a population of people that actually did that and are like on the streets right now, which is like horrible. Hopefully that's a small population. And, you know, theoretically the state has programs to try to help those people. So hopefully they're getting that help.
That's a homelessness question.
Yeah, that is. Yep.
About that.
Yeah. Other thoughts on this one, guys?
I also think it's a good like thing. I mean, it's extra money, and like you're helping people that's like struggling on the deep end. And like, yeah, it doesn't seem fair, but like, you know, it's extra money that we're not going to use anyways on our budget. And if we don't use it, it's going to get cut. And then like,
yeah. Yeah. And the money goes to the landlord, presumably. So, you know, yeah. Things are and like cool.
Puts the economy back on place. And then instead of like pushing people to the extreme and like make them like become homeless and not pay taxes on like different stuff. You know, you're like putting a person back on the right track to like pay income tax and like pay sales tax and like, you know.
I'm a little confused. Is this the money that was coming from the federal government?
I think there's two concurrent programs at the same time.
Okay. Because I feel like some of the rent relief was coming from the federal government as a result of the a lot of those bills that were passed under Trump's administration and under Biden's administration. There were like relief bills that were passed, the CARES Act, the HEROES Act or whatever. So like that money was going to be coming to the state regardless. So I felt like it would have been like royally irresponsible for Newsom and this administration to be like, no, thanks. We're good. We don't need that money. Sorry. Like we're going to get it anyway. Just like, you know, so I think it's
good. That's true. That's a good point. You know, maybe he's wasting this money because we're getting it anyways. So yeah. Something to think about. Okay, there's nothing else on this. Let's move on to if you guys think the unemployment fiasco is reason enough to recall the governor. So background, basically, obviously a lot of people lost their jobs and they had to file for unemployment. And so there's a record number of claims. And so in order to get these claims taken care of, the agency, which is the EDD, I forgot what it actually stands for. But they basically relaxed their fraud processes, whatever, and just to get money out. And so this resulted in total $265 billion, paid out, but $11 billion were identified as fraudulent and $19 billion are identified as suspicious payments out of $164 billion total. Okay. And so basically, question is this Newsom's fault? Was he supposed to have a handle on it? Does he deserve to be kicked out because of this?
What's the percentage wise?
Percentage wise, 11 out of 164 is precisely. Six point 7% fraudulent, and then suspicious 19 out of 164, 11.5%. So 11.5 plus whatever I just said. Yeah.
And just to clarify, when you say fraudulent, you're saying that there are people that had jobs applying for EDD and getting.
There are certainly a number of people that fall into that category. There's also people that. You know, steal your identity, they buy your socials off of some website and they apply for claims under your name. There's also people that, you know, maybe know a bunch of like, I don't know, immigrants or seniors somewhere and they go just take, use their names and their addresses, and, you know, collect their debit cards or whatever. There are organized crime rings that do this. So there's like, you can imagine it, it's happened. Question is how big or significant the problem is. And apparently it's under the label fraudulent, there's 11 billion out of 164.
Give or take like 20%, right?
I don't know.
Yeah,
it takes some, gotta dive into that.
Like one out of four person?
No, no, not that high.
Right. 1 out of 5.
So the for sure was like 6.7%. And then the suspicious, what the department has to review is 11.
Oh, okay. 15%. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, so max it'd be like 16-17%.
Okay. Yeah, I mean like for like the good and bad ratio is like pretty well, right? I mean, you do anything, there's gonna be like good outcomes and bad outcomes. Is this like the ratio of like how like it balances?
And I don't know exactly like how much of that 11 billion is from, you know, barbers versus, you know, people who steal identities. So, but like as a voter, you're right, your judgment call is looking at these numbers. Everyone's looking at the same number, 11 billion. You know, do you think that that's too much? Like the reasoning for that number being that high was relaxing the standard in order to get money out to people who, you know, lost their jobs, right? So do you think that that was overall a good call and we'll try to reform the processes, get a new director in there, by the way, which we did. The director was retired probably involuntarily in December. So there's a new director right now. You know, how much of this is the governor's fault? So these are the judgment calls that you're asking yourself, right? Like, hey, maybe we should have been strict and slower to get the money out, right? Because, you know, I value public money being used well more than I value people who just lost their job. They need to eat, right? They can just maybe hang out for a couple months, you know, figure it out, right? It's better to do that, right? So this is your judgment call. So thoughts on that?
My was pissed also.
They can just hang out for a couple months. I'm pretty sure you understood that they could just hang out.
Well, there was a whole thing where like you receive EDD is basically like as much as how much I make. Like I was working like 5 days a week and you were just chilling at your house, you know, making like at 4K also or like 2K a week or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I would counter argue that like the problem is not that the benefits were so generous. The problem is that, you know, wages are stagnant. Yeah. That's not cool. Like large companies should be raising their wages writ large instead of bilking their workers overall. And then that would encourage other, you know, that would have a sort of ripple effect throughout the labor market. You know, like if Walmart were to raise wages overall, or if Amazon were to raise wages overall, that would become the new market standard because they're such big companies that employ a huge amount of workers that like other smaller entities would then have to raise their wages to compete. So I think, you know, they've been keeping wages artificially low just because they can, because it's sort of what's called a it's like the opposite of a monopoly. It's like instead of there being only one seller of a good, there's only like one or only a few employers, right? Because there are so few employers, they manage so many different workers. It's like they can afford to just be like, yeah, take it or leave it. Like, good luck finding work elsewhere. So I think that's the real fucking scandal. But I will get off my soapbox and say that it was cool. I think unemployment benefits being higher during a crisis is very necessary, but that's just me.
I agree, but I also think that, like, I think this just shows us how old in technology our government is. I think we need a revamp because I think it's possible to do more checking, like verification, just automated verification if we have the right infrastructure, which we don't. So I think this just highlights, oh, you know, our technology in the government is a problem that needs to be.
I agree. Wait, Anna, you work for the city. What is the the stuff like? Is there really old, out of date technology that you have to work with?
Paper forms. I think Anna's probably still waking up, so she might not respond.
Sorry, I'll be right back. I have to deal with something.
Okay.
No problem.
Deal with Anna. Wake up!
Right.
I actually like that you think, you know, because, like, yeah. It's a special circumstance, like you guys said. And like the ratio is like good enough to like help more people than like, you know, the bad thing coming out where people.
Yeah, it's, in my head, it's like, oh, it's government money that we pay taxes to give it to them. And now it's just going back to the people. It may not be going back to the right people all the time, but it at least it's going back to the people.
Yeah. Also for operation, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, so you guys are kind of like following that. You ever heard the quote where it's like better to let 10 guilty people walk free than to condemn one innocent person?
Yeah.
I guess that's kind of the vibe here, right? It's better that people who get help, and then people that didn't need help, you know, we'll fix their process, hopefully. There are people that are trying to track down this money. And obviously you're committing a crime when you're committing fraud. So we directly have systems for that where, you know, we have law enforcement agencies that are supposed to prosecute those crimes. So yeah. All right, it's 11:25. Maybe an open discussion. Any other questions anyone has, or any thoughts on how they're voting, any questions?
I'm really curious about what candidate people are going to put for the second
question. Oh, yeah, the candidates, dude. Yeah. And did you read your book yet, dude?
Dude, I literally just scrolled through the one that Carmen sent, and I was so shocked to see this one guy. Hold up. There's this one guy that says, you probably know what I'm talking about already, dude. There's one dude.
Love you guy?
Hold up. Let me see if I can find it.
That was my favorite.
Dude, wow. Like, I'm just so impressed. Like, you have to, Dan Kapelowitz literally just has a picture of him with glasses on, and it says, "Can you dig it?" on page 19 of that document. Look at this.
He trolls, dude.
Look at this.
Yep, that's how I'm voting for him.
Look at this.
Waste the money.
You're telling me this dude paid money to get on this?
Exactly. I think he paid like $4,000.
Wow.
Yeah, that's it. Like, he's one cool dude. He got my vote.
What a great.
There's love you guy too. There you
go. Yeah.
Love you.
Oh my god, all these like
Los Angeles, Hollywood.
But just love you. Wow.
I mean, there's always like a couple candidates on every ballot who make it onto there and are just like trying to like as a joke. But I think this recall election in particular really brought them all out to play.
Yeah. This was even less than a...
Yo, that love you guy has a TikTok.
Of course.
Yeah.
You looked him up?
No. It's in his description.
Oh, it's on his thing.
It's in his description.
Oh, cool.
He's doing it for his followers.
He got his Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, and a YouTube.
He's doing it for
us. I noticed that the top Democrat who is in contention for, he's not listed there. I kept looking. He doesn't have like a picture or whatever.
Wait, the YouTube guy?
Yeah, the YouTube guy. I didn't see a little description for him. I guess he didn't submit a description or whatever.
Oh, is that true? Interesting.
I didn't see one there on the document. I don't know if you looked. I
totally forgot. I'm looking at
it. His name's like Paffrath.
Kevin. No? Yeah, Kevin Paffrath. Yeah, that sounds right.
I didn't see him there, but he is listed in like the list of names on the, and he's on the ballot, of course. But oh, do you guys want to see the polling on this?
Sure.
If I share my screen.
Let me stop.
So according to 538.com, which are the people that I generally trust for polling in general, because I think they're very upfront about their methodology and whatnot. They're saying that right now, you know, it's like it narrowed quite a bit at one point. And that's why like people were like, oh shit, it's over. We lost. But it seems to be getting a little bit better. But here is who should replace the governor. This is the current spread. There's all the random candidates.
Larry and then there are the Elder.
Larry Elder is the top candidate, and he is a tried and true Republican, I think. If you, yeah, so if you want to look up his name, I think we should focus on. Paffrath is somebody we should focus on, and John Cox is somebody we should focus on. I think John Cox, he ran against Newsom in 2018, right? He was like the only, and he lost. He was like their main
candidate. He runs every time.
Yeah, he's like the perennial candidate for the Republicans.
Pops at least in the state. Running all the time.
Yeah, if you're rich, what else are you gonna do?
But he's been making some waves based on his advertisements. Like his ads have been really like in your face. Like he has like a bear that's like hitting a desk. You guys seen some of these ads? They're wild.
This guy drags, so wild. He drags a live bear around to his like press conferences and stuff.
Does he?
A live bear?
At least Cox? Once. And he got a lot of flack because it was like chained up and shit. Like it's not a good look.
It's not a good look. But I think he knows that at this point, the only way that he's going to garner any votes is by being a spectacle. Because I don't think he can run on a record.
I see.
I don't think he can run on good policy. I don't think, you know?
Yeah, recall elections are historically super interesting. There were 100 candidates when Schwarzenegger won.
Oh, really?
Jeez. Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah, there are more Democratic candidates that were...
That makes me wonder, what is the criteria to run for governor?
Nothing. You just have, nothing? You even have to be a citizen, yeah. I mean, wait, you don't have to be naturalized. I mean, you don't have to be born here, sorry. That's fine.
Just got to file all the paperwork.
I think there's residency requirements, too, but that's a given, I think.
Should there be higher requirements, you think?
Good question. I mean...
Like having to... You have to have held prior office or something like that?
No. Like education. But you know that congresswoman in Colorado, Boebert, you guys know she didn't have her GED until she ran for office. She got her GED. Wow. And she won.
While she was running for office?
Yeah, she got her GED like right before she... And she's like 40 or something.
What did she do for a living?
She owns a restaurant that's like themed, like gun owner themed or whatever.
Yeah, okay.
Interesting. Anyway,
look her up, bro. She's funny.
I want to look. Yeah. It's a real clown car of candidates. But
I voted for the freaking the college student, John Drake or something.
John Drake.
Why? Because he's not going to win, and I respect him.
All right.
Look, he's trying to make it happen.
Yeah, he is.
He's trying to make it happen.
But young.
Community college graduate.
He's a community college graduate.
Ventura Community College.
Yeah, I'm not saying I'm just saying I vote.
They don't have Democrat, any idea who they're going to put in their ballot?
The main Democrat is Kevin Paffrath.
Right.
I watched the debate that I think it was NBC who hosted it or something, or maybe it was another news channel. It was Paffrath, John Cox, the San Diego governor, and someone else. It was just four candidates on the stage. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I got turned off by Patra is because he's smart. Like, I could tell he's smart, but he was like aggressive smart. Like, as a leader, that's not someone I would trust as a leader, just because he was very aggressive in his talking.
Yeah.
Like, all the other candidates were very neutral in their stance and how they like addressed the question, but he was like very aggressive about it. So I was like, I don't know.
Interesting.
Don't need the energy.
I'm just trying to be curious, because I'm curious, like, is it that there are some stances that he's really stubborn about and he's not opening to considering other options? Is that what you, like, I'm just curious what you meant. That's all. Okay.
I'll try to find a clip later.
This is the YouTuber, right?
He's a YouTuber.
I found a debate streamed live on August 4th. Was it the August 4th debate? Or was it an even more recent one?
Carmen, when was the debate?
The recent one.
Recent one.
What day was it?
3 days ago?
Maybe? Yeah, KCRA.
Maybe. It was just 3 days ago?
Mm-hmm. I have this, and yes. Any other general thoughts, guys? I already filled my stuff. I'm about to send it. Done. It's too easy. Two questions.